As soon as this is over, I'm gonna buy one of those. That's much more humane than hollering, which is what I usually do. Can everybody hear us? Okay, hear me? Okay. So my name is Sean Fitzpatrick, and I am the director of the Jung Center. This is Ginger Clarkson, who is the Dharma leader for Insight Meditation Houston, among many other hats she wears. I'm going to tell you a little bit about her in a moment. I just want to welcome everybody here this evening to this very first event of the spring semester. There are many familiar faces to me here in the audience and a lot of folks that I've never seen before. And I just want to tell, particularly if you're new to the Jung Center, I'm so glad that you chose to join us tonight. I hope that you'll find this a welcoming and warm place. Let me know if you don't. We want to know that too. The Jung Center is, as you found us, I hope there wasn't too much trouble parking this evening. The Jung Center, of course, is situated here in the heart of Houston's Museum District. Our soul is situated at the crossroads of psychology, creativity, and the human spirit. And in a given year, we host more than 200 events like this. Lectures, workshops, courses, conferences, special events. And I encourage you, if you enjoy the experience tonight, if you find something meaningful here, to come on back. We should have your contact information now. You should start to hear from us. In any case, it's wonderful to see you all here this evening. We are very happy to be partnering with two organizations tonight on this, and I mentioned Insight Meditation Houston, and Ginger will tell you a little bit more about the work of Insight Meditation Houston later in the evening. I also want to acknowledge very briefly at this point a new initiative of Commonweal, which is a nonprofit organization based in California. The initiative is based here in Houston. It's called Healing Circles Houston. And when you sat down, you may have found a small sheet of paper that says join the circle, and we'll talk more about that toward the end of the evening. All of these are nonprofit initiatives and with really similar simpatico missions and goals. So I am delighted to be here with Ginger. I mentioned that she's the Dharma leader for Insight Meditation Houston. She's also a music therapist, and not just a music therapist, but a trainer of music therapists. How long have you been practicing?
I started practicing in 1971, before some of you were born. And I've done international trainings in something called guided imagery and music, which is a wonderful use of classical music to elicit inner imagery and memory.
And you've taught, Ginger also teaches classes here for us, and you've taught on the Bonnie Method.
The Bonnie Method of guided imagery and music.
And on many other topics as well. So I just want to tell you by way of context, really I'm second banana here tonight and very proud to be second banana to Ginger. But I want to give just a little bit of context for how this came about. You might have gotten a sense if you read the description of the program what was preoccupying Ginger and I when we came up with this program. We've never hosted a program so early in the spring semester before, and quite frankly, I'm startled and very pleased that y'all are here with us. I thought it might be just Ginger and I here sitting and listening to each other for an hour and a half. We shared, I think we got together in late November, early December, somewhere in there, and had a conversation about our reactions to not simply the events of November 8th, the outcome of the presidential election nationally, but of the entire election cycle and more broadly, the change, what we perceived as a significant change in the quality of the discourse in this country and the capacity of the community to hold a constructive conversation. And one of our reactions was to lament that, to mourn it, mm-hmm. and to wonder if there wasn't some small way in which we could begin to contribute to a change in that reality. What I would say is that this is cultivating empathy, which is one way of talking about what we're doing tonight. It's a very specific practice for developing your empathic capacities. That this is for me, and Ginger, I will want to hear your thoughts too, but for me, this is something that is essential if we want to contribute to change, if we have change that we want to see happen in society, that we, if we want to do that, if we want to act with integrity, that we have a need to hear how this change will affect the other, okay? And we have a need to relate to the others in our lives. And one of the things that I certainly have seen I could take it back 20 years, maybe further, but certainly it's become acute in the national conversation in the last several years, is that lack of the capacity to listen, even to achieve disagreement, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. To maintain respect and connection with the other, even as we may disagree with them. So I want to say one more thing, which is briefly before I turn it over to Ginger, which is that I want to be very careful not to talk about the outcome of what we do today as understanding. Like, so my goal in this is not to understand. You'll see Ginger and I exchange conversation, some dialogue, and my goal is not to understand Ginger, I just want to talk about what that means for me. So I'm going to come out right now as a white guy, a straight white guy, a cisgender straight white guy. For those of us who don't know that cool language that the kids are using now, cisgender means simply that my body expresses the gender that I experience myself to be. Okay? Mm-hmm. So as, you know, and we also talk about transgender and gender queer and some other ways of talking about gender. I'm a straight white dude. I'm among the tribe that has had the most privilege of any tribe on the face of the earth throughout history, and also has been notoriously unaware of our privilege. For me to have a conversation with somebody that I understand to be different than me, mm-hmm. if I do that and I leave and I say, oh, I understand that person now. Now I understand that person. I think that's a seduction and a false comfort. And it's a way of cutting off my own obligation to the other person and cutting off the capacity that encounter with the other, with relating with other people, has to change me as a human being. If I say, well, I understand this person's experience. You know, I understand the gay experience. I understand the black experience. I understand the trans experience. Well, that's shutting me out. And it's also a form of colonization. It's a form of saying, now I own you. Now I have you in a little box in my mind and I get you. So I guess I would say that that's not actually what I'm after. And Ginger, you might have a different perspective on it. But
Well, I feel as if the main purpose of tonight is to reestablish civility in dialogue. So that there's a sense of waiting to really hear what someone is saying, to pause and digest what the person's saying before just making a judgment or an opinion. And so the only way to do that I know is to practice, because we're out of practice. We're out of practice in our personal realm, and we're out of practice on a national level, and certainly internationally. I mean, there's so much strife, and it's on a different level because we're not even sure what news is true, what news is false. Yeah. And it leads to tremendous breakdown in relationships on many, many levels, because you need to have trust in order to relate in any profundity. So that's what we're hoping to achieve.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
So should we do a little meditation? What I'm thinking would be good is to just get us very centered before we actually get into the stage of dialoguing. So if you could sit in a comfortable position and close your eyes and turn the attention inward. And And as you sit there, try to scan your body so that you notice where there are relaxed places in the body and where there might be points of tension. And if you just scan from the head down, notice the muscles in your face. And if you can, just let them relax and soften. And notice your neck, which holds a lot of tension, the connection between body and mind. And as you breathe into the neck, just let it relax and soften. Shoulders are often up high around the ears, and just let them soften and go. And as you sit there, see if you can bring some dignity to your posture so that your spine is erect without rigidity. And there's a sense that the crown of the head is towards the sky, and the chin is slightly tucked in. And your hands can be softly on your lap or your legs. Often we clench the hands, and so just be aware if there's any tension in your hands. Soften the belly. Often that's a place of clenching and holding. And then make sure that the feet are grounded, that there's a sense of contact with the floor. You can even imagine that your feet are softening and opening to receive support from the earth. And we're taking some time to connect to the body, because the body really doesn't lie. The body tells the truth about how we're feeling. And often we get so speedy and revved up and centered in the head that we forget to check with the body. So as you turn inward, notice where in the body you most obviously sense the passage of breath. For some people, that's below the nostrils on the upper lip. Sense the breath moving in and out. For others, it may be most obvious in the chest as it expands and contracts. And for others, it may be more of a full body breathing, starting in the abdomen or the belly. So as you notice the breath, this indication of life, which we so seldom really pay attention to. Notice the beginning, the middle, and the ending of each in-breath. The pause between in and out-breaths. And the beginning, middle, and ending of each out-breath. And any time that you notice that your attention is wandering, which is very, very normal, natural, simply noting in silence to yourself, thinking, trying not to get caught up in the content of the thought, neither jumping forward into planning for the future, nor falling back into memories of the past. Just simply noting the thought as if it were a cloud arising and passing away in the empty sky of the mind. No need to grasp or grab hold of anything. And then gently inviting the attention back to this breath in the chosen place in the body, just as it is. No need to manipulate or control anything. Just noticing which breaths are long, which breaths are short, deep or shallow, rough or smooth. So just take one moment in silence, focusing on the breath, and the bell will ring in a little bit to bring you back. Gently opening your eyes and sense if there's any difference in your perception and in your feelings from 5 minutes ago before we started this meditation, mini meditation. You know, it really shifts everything, and it only takes 5 minutes. You can do that any time of the day.
Thank you so much, yeah. Mm-hmm. This is when I was a graduate student, I had the great fortune of taking a class that was called Contemplative Practice in Psychotherapy. The change, and I'm somebody who listens professionally, right? For better or for worse, I don't think I see any clients in here, so they might lodge objections, but that's part of my task, right? My work, and I can't tell you how much it changes the experience, how much easier it is to have 5 minutes before a session to do just that, yep. To just come to presence.
Yeah,
how much it changes the quality of listening.
Yeah, and as a music therapist, since I listen to music a lot, it's essential.
Yeah.
Essential.
So, do you want to tell them a little bit about how the rest of the evening is structured?
Mm-hmm.
Where are we going?
Okay, so what we're going to be doing is actually you're going to be involved a lot in this evening. Sean and I are going to give a little demonstration about dialoguing, and all of us are going to be dealing with a question, and the question is, how can I most skillfully care for myself and for our planet? Okay, so that's kind of an unanswerable question, but we're going to have short opportunities to speak. One person will speak and a partner will listen. And then the partner will listen so all in silence, not saying anything while the other person is speaking for 3 minutes. And 3 minutes can be a long time. Time is elastic. And at the end of the 3 minutes, the partner, you both close your eyes and just digest how it felt to have one person speaking and one person listening. And then the listener will repeat back to the partner what they heard as carefully as they can, okay? And then we'll change partners. I mean, we'll just change roles in the partnership. But part of this process is going to be checking out how you feel in your body and what's going on in each step of the process, so that it's going to be a little bit like taking the process that we just did in silent meditation off the cushion, as we say, into relationship, into dialogue. So we'll be kind of helping you look at how you're feeling along the way. And the first thing that Sean and I will do as we demonstrate, is we're just going to sit silently with our eyes closed, feeling the presence of each other, just feeling what it's like to be in somebody else's presence. So seldom do we take that in before we speak. So we're going to do that and see what we can pick up about each other. And then we'll open our eyes and do what we call soft gazing for just a nanosecond. So don't get nervous. You're not going to fall into each other's eyes. We're just going to do what we call soft gazing, which means that when you look into each other's eyes, you're making yourself available. Now, often we use hard eyes and we are hypervigilant. We're looking out. And we want to protect ourselves. So what we're going to try to do tonight is soften the gaze to allow ourselves to be seen, even for a second, to just let yourself be seen with all the joys and sorrows. Okay? And then nonverbally, you will indicate who will go first in the partnership. And then the other person silently listens and brings full attention, okay? So you'll see how we do. And at the end of our shifting back and forth as partners, you can vote on who's the best.
Okay. Ginger and I were talking earlier about making sure that we don't
fall off.
It would be really deep listening.
Really
happens,
deep.
Happens on the floor.
Okay. So we will, the question, we're going to first reflect a little bit in silence and close our eyes and just feel each other's. So the question is, how can I most skillfully care for myself and for the planet? So we'll close our eyes. And then we'll open our eyes and just very softly for just a minute, look into each other's eyes. And be seen. And then we'll indicate nonverbally who goes first. Okay. The way that I feel like I can best care for myself and the planet is to be very centered and to practice meditation, not only with Insight Meditation Houston, which I do once a week, but to do that every day. Mm-hmm. And to make sure that I have a daily routine keeps me grounded.
What is that? What is that? What do you mean by grounded?
I like to start off each day with some qigong and qigong exercises, and to really, it's kind of hard for me to talk with you twitching around like that.
Was that I was twitching around?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry, yeah, I'll do a better job.
Okay. So what I was saying was that I like to start off with grounding myself with some qigong exercises and some prayer.
Did you say, what is qigong? What is
it? It's a form of slow body movement.
Okay, okay. And I'm with you.
And I like to also, through prayer, just connect with my heart. Because when I'm connected to my heart, I feel like I'm more able to receive the people who come in to my day in relationship. Uh-huh. And then I also feel like I need to pause more when I'm conversing with people. I tend to be quite clear about how I feel about things, quite expressive. Mm-hmm. And I like to pause from time to time to make sure that the other person is with me.
Okay. Well, that sounds like, that sounds like a good practice. Yeah.
And also that to give them a chance to respond in depth. And caring for the planet, I feel like in my own garden, I can be sure that I'm taking care of planting some flowers to attract butterflies, and then I can give donations to World Wildlife Fund and other organizations that I care about.
Has it been 3 minutes yet?
Okay.
The straight face. You can hold the vote now.
Okay. All right, you're on. No. So now you have to repeat back what you heard me say.
Something about Qigong, something about the World Wildlife Fund, pausing. I remember us talking about pausing a lot.
So
you can see, and, I was
okay.
Distracted.
Okay, so essentially what we've shown you is how not to do it, right?
Do you want to take a quick minute to process that? What did you see me do that?
Yeah, let's do that.
Was problematic. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Twitching.
It was subtle. It was something that we all do. It wasn't anything grand. It was just real needling kinds of irritations that are not always obvious to the person who's supposed to be listening. That you don't realize, and that was very that was obvious that you were giving us a lesson. Yeah. But we do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I do that all the time. Mm-hmm. John.
I got a lesson in a new kind of interruption. I would have thought with listening, but I've been doing it, but watching it seemed like an interruption, which was when Ginger spoke, and she hadn't even really quite finished her thought, and you said, oh, yeah, that sounds like a good practice.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of self-recognition.
Seems a little familiar.
I think there's an Emmy Award.
Okay. So we'll get.
Do you have a quick comment? Yeah, and the body.
Yes.
That deep sigh. The biggest laugh.
Which is so unconscious too.
I know that I did that unconsciously. Hadn't been mentioned are all the external distractions when you're trying to have a conversation and the door is rambling.
Yeah.
Somebody's listening to their cell phone or excuse me, I gotta listen to this, and it just raises my tension level. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I had taken my cell phone out, left at my desk. I had that thought halfway through. Yeah. I was like, I need to start monkeying with my cell phone. I do it all the time.
Yes.
I think also when the person who's speaking is put off by the response, that can be a distraction.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yes. Yeah.
Sure.
There's also that question when you're yawning, is are you that tired, or you have a headache, or are you bored? Mm-hmm. So it just, there's sometimes there's things that have happened that you really are physically tired and trying to mentally, but then sometimes you're bored.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, he felt bored. Yes.
Maybe there's a little distinction one needs to make between self-awareness and self-consciousness. Yeah. Self-awareness, it seems like you're more in tune with what the person's saying. Self-conscious, maybe you're just becoming more aware of yourself and tuning out the person.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's lovely. Yeah, I really like that.
Yeah, I like that. Deirdre, did you have a comment?
Oh, I'm under, overall, there's just a lack of connection.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, there's a lack of connection.
Mm-hmm. It was interesting to see over here, actually, you, the speaker, lose a little bit of your train of thought.
Yeah.
And so it was really an obvious interruption that you were now not talking and having a relationship about your talking and feeling validated and important about your talking and your message. It was let me try to now think about what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was startled by that too.
Mm-hmm.
So do we want to...
I'm not sure we need to model... I think you get it. Okay, we're changing our minds.
We'll do it briefly.
We're going to do a brief, like a minute of modeling what we are looking for. Okay, just because some people in the back were saying, we need to see how it could be. Okay, so let's hope we can do this.
Hey, it's all on you. My job's easy here. And to refresh all of our memories, including me, the question is, how do I skillfully take care of myself and the world?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, so let's get centered again. Okay.
So, how do I skillfully take care of myself is maybe an easier question. Maybe not. It's harder to answer or to enact, right,
mm-hmm.
in real life, but maybe more immediate for me. So the thing that I struggle with in self-care is, I think, first of all, making the space in my time, in my schedule, and also in my the place I live, my home, and my, you know, I had, before my child was born, before Danny was born, I had, you know, I'd meditate 20 minutes in the morning, often, and again at night. I had a good practice, and then it just vanished, right? You know, I couldn't sleep. My sleep got all upset, and then I couldn't meditate anymore. So for me, the first piece of self-care is to return to that daily practice, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And another big piece of caring for myself involves saying no. It's really hard for me to say no to things, to people, you know, particularly other people's feeling, people who are asking me to do things because they need them to be done. So that's important for me right now. I'd like to believe that taking care of the world has something to do with being as present to my own needs in the moment as I can. Once I'm centered, as it were, mm-hmm. right? Once I'm attending to my own needs, then it makes it easier to make decisions about caring for others or being involved in the world in a way that isn't going to exhaust me or isn't going to diminish me. So I think that's,
mm-hmm.
is that useful? That was perfect, right? Mm-hmm. I guess I was paying very, you know, I felt drawn in completely by your presence. And yeah, did you comment?
Is it better to shake the head with agreement or is it better to just remain still?
You know, what I would do is what feels really natural in your body. Okay, stay in touch with your body, because I wasn't trying to shake my head at any particular time, or it's just if you are comfortable in your body and really receiving, your body will just respond. Okay. So let it respond. Don't be thinking, what should I do? Yeah. No, because, and we'll have you come back and over and over and over again to the body, okay, and to the breath. So we'll keep reminding you along the way, okay? So you won't be doing this without guidance. Yeah. So when you turn to your partner, just close your eyes face to face and sense the presence of the person. So you're not doing anything except sitting face to face with somebody with your eyes closed. Okay?
So are we ready to, yeah, to set people, yeah, on that? So yeah. take
Pam, yeah, we'll make sure, yeah, everyone has a part. Okay. So please do not speak. That's hard, but try to sit quietly with your eyes closed facing your partner. And sense energetically what it's like to be face to face with somebody. So you have your eyes closed and you're not alone. You've got somebody right there with you. And just sense, does this feel like it's really energetically charged space between you, or does it feel very calm? What does it feel like? Just receive on a bodily level that person's presence. And then very gently open your eyes, and for just about 15 seconds, softly gaze into the other person's eyes. Just make yourself available, soft gaze, where you let yourself be seen. It's a non-judgmental presence. And as you do that, indicate non-verbally who's going to speak first. And try not to come to blows about who's going to come first. Okay, so once you've decided who's going to go first, I will ring the bell for you to start. And the theme is the same as what Sean and I were discussing. How can I care skillfully for myself and for the planet? And you will have only 3 minutes, so don't perfectionistically try to solve this issue in 3 minutes. It's just to start the ball rolling. Okay, so the other person's job is to listen attentively without saying one word. Okay. Close your eyes and digest. How did that feel to speak and be listened to? And for the person who was the nonverbal witness, how hard was that to not say a word, to have the desire to vocalize, and how challenging this practice is? Notice how you feel inside right now. Is there excitement in the energy inside your body? Do you still feel grounded? Are you in touch with your breath? Are there any places in the body that feel tense or tight? And breathe into those places and just get yourself recentered, connected to yourself. And we'll switch roles, right? You can open your eyes and the other person's turn. Close your eyes and close your mouth and sense how you feel inside. How was it to speak? How do you feel energized, depleted? How was it to listen without saying a word? Was that challenging? Was that hard? And now you're going to repeat back to one another what you heard. So the first person to repeat back will be the first listener. And you will have 1 minute to say to your partner what you heard them say, and then we'll ring the bell, and the other person will have 1 minute to say what you heard your partner say. Okay, so open your eyes, and the first person goes and says what they heard. Ahem! Okay, and the other person has a chance to say what they heard. Okay.
And go.
Go! Okay. Quiet, 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 quiet. This is hard. This is hard what we're asking you to do. And part of the stopping with the bell is a part of the practice is knowing how to stop. And we don't do that very easily. We love to talk. Listening is complicated, and we act as if, oh, it's just a passive, you know, I don't really have to participate. But if you are really deeply listening, you're engaged, and you notice your responses. Mm-hmm. You don't have to verbalize them, but you notice them. And then you keep bringing your attention back to what the person's saying, just as you do in the meditation, bringing your attention back to the breath. Yeah, so it's not that different a practice, but we forget when we're engaged in conversation that this is practice. You know, it's hard work to really listen. When you are the listener, each time that you have an impulse to interrupt, take a deep breath and really concentrate on that breath. Okay? And also sense your feet on the ground. So you're substituting breathing and feeling your feet. Okay? And stay with what they're saying. Okay? It's important for the speaker to notice when you have judgments coming in. My teacher, Jack Kornfield, is a wonderful sense of humor, and he says, if you have judgments coming in, you can say, thank you for your opinion, and just go right back to your breath. Because it's usually some old voice from our past that's saying, you know, that's stupid, when it's not. No, it's just an opinion.
We wanted to give you some opportunities, some possibilities for next steps. around the conversation that we have tonight. First of all, thank you so much for being mm-hmm. here and for the attention and presence that you've given the work tonight. Let me turn this over to you for a moment. Can you talk a little bit about Insight Meditation Houston mm-hmm. and your teaching?
Insight Meditation Houston has been going on for many, many years. It was founded by Rodney Smith in the 80s. He was a hospice worker here. And when he moved away, the organization got a little bit smaller. And now we're meeting every Monday night at the First UU Church, right across the green.
Over on Fannin.
On Fannin Street. And we meet from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. And it's free of charge. Parking is free. And it's a circle of people who really are working on being conscious and being mindful. And we practice in silence for about a half an hour, and then I give a Dharma talk, or someone else will give a Dharma talk about applying principles of Buddhist philosophy to daily living. And it's a really beautiful group of people, and you're most welcome to come any Monday night that it fits into your life. You don't have to come every Monday, and there's no homework. And you don't have to talk.
Is there a fee?
There's no fee. It's just a voluntary donation if you feel so inclined.